Hello everyone, I am Dr. Trupti. Welcome to my YouTube channel Enjoy Biochemistry. Today let's learn about very common but important metabolic disorder, that is diabetes mellitus. Diabetes mellitus, commonly known as diabetes, it is a group of metabolic diseases characterized by hyperglycemia, that is increased blood glucose, resulting from defects in insulin secretion, insulin action or both, and disturbances of carbohydrate, fat and protein metabolism. The chronic hyperglycemia of diabetes is associated with long-term damage, dysfunction and failure of different organs, especially eyes, kidneys, heart, blood vessels and nerves. People with diabetes are also at increased risk of other diseases including heart, that is coronary heart disease, peripheral vascular diseases, cerebrovascular diseases, obesity, cataracts, erectile dysfunction and non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. They are also at increased risk of some infectious diseases such as tuberculosis. Now let's see the classification of diabetes. The vast majority of cases of diabetes fall into one of two broad classes, that is type 1 diabetes and type 2 diabetes. And out of these two types, 80 to 90% of cases of diabetes, they are of type 2 diabetes. Type 1 diabetes, it is characterized by pancreatic beta cell destruction and absolute deficiency of insulin, and this is the autoimmune disease. Type 2 diabetes, it is caused by combination of peripheral resistance to insulin action, that is insulin resistance, and inadequate secretory response by the pancreatic beta cells, that is relative insulin deficiency. So in type 1 diabetes there is absolute insulin deficiency, and in type 2 diabetes there is insulin resistance as well as relative insulin deficiency. Then there are specific types of diabetes due to other causes like monogenic diabetes syndrome, neonatal diabetes and monogenic diabetes of young. Diseases of exocrine pancreas like cystic fibrosis, pancreatitis, then drug or chemical induced diabetes like glucocorticoids and anti-HIV drugs. The fourth type is gestational diabetes mellitus. For diagnosis of diabetes, four diagnostic tests are currently recommended, including measurement of fasting plasma glucose, 2-hour post-load plasma glucose after a 75-gram oral glucose tolerance test, HbA1c, that is glycated hemoglobin, and a random blood glucose in the presence of signs and symptoms of diabetes. And based on the values of these parameters, the individuals are categorized as normal, pre-diabetes and diabetes. Pre-diabetes is as such not any clinical entity, but these individuals, they are at increased risk of developing diabetes and cardiovascular diseases. So the normal value of glycated hemoglobin, that is HbA1c, it is less than 5.7%. While fasting plasma glucose in normal individual, it should be less than 100 mg per deciliter. And 2-hour post-load glucose on oral glucose tolerance test should be less than 140 mg per deciliter. Now in pre-diabetes, the HbA1c, if it is more than or equal to 5.7% to 6.4%, it is considered as pre-diabetes. And fasting plasma glucose, if it is more than or equal to 100 mg per deciliter to 125 mg per deciliter, it is pre-diabetes. It is called as impaired fasting glucose. And 2-hour post-load glucose, if it is more than or equal to 140 mg per deciliter to 199 mg per deciliter, it is considered as pre-diabetes, that is impaired glucose tolerance. Now in diabetes, HbA1c is more than or equal to 6.5%. Fasting plasma glucose is more than or equal to 126 mg per deciliter. And 2-hour post-load glucose on oral glucose tolerance test is more than or equal to 200 mg per deciliter. As per American Diabetic Association guidelines, the diagnostic criteria for diabetes includes, first, if the fasting plasma glucose is more than or equal to 126 mg per deciliter, fasting is defined as no calorie intake for at least 8 hours. Or the second criteria is if 2-hour Postload glucose is more than or equal to 200 milligram per deciliter during oral glucose tolerance test, and this test should be performed as per the WHO guidelines using a glucose load of 75 gram anhydrous glucose dissolved in water. So this is the second criteria. Or HbA1c, that is glycated hemoglobin, more than or equal to 6.5%, and this test should be performed using a method that is certified by the National Glycohemoglobin Standardization Program, that is NGSP, and traceable to the Diabetic Control and Complications Trial Reference Assay, that is DCCT assay. Or the fourth criteria is a random plasma glucose more than or equal to 200 mg per deciliter in patient with classic symptoms of hyperglycemia or hyperglycemic crisis. And please note that in the absence of unequivocal hyperglycemia, diagnosis requires two abnormal test results from the same sample or in two separate test samples. So all tests except the random blood glucose test in a patient with classic hyperglycemic signs need to be repeated and confirmed on a separate day. We know that type 1 diabetes is an autoimmune disease characterized by pancreatic beta cell destruction and absolute deficiency of insulin. This is the most common form of diabetes in childhood. However, it can present at any age. And type 1 diabetes is 10% of diagnosed cases of diabetes. There is progressive decrease in the insulin level seen in type 1 diabetes. And most patients, they depend on exogenous insulin for survival. There is diabetic ketoacidosis. If insulin therapy is not given, it is the acute complication seen in the patients of type 1 diabetes. Although the clinical onset is abrupt, it results from a chronic autoimmune attack on the beta cells that usually starts year before the disease becomes evident, and classic manifestations of the disease such as ketoacidosis, they occur late in its course after more than 90% of the beta cells have been destroyed. And the most classic symptoms of diabetes are polyuria, polydipsia and polyphagia. So 3P are very important. Polyuria means there is excessive or an abnormal production or passage of urine, which ultimately leads to increased thirst and increased consumption of fluid, that is polydipsia, and excessive or abnormal hunger is called as polyphagia. These three P's are also associated with one more P in diabetes, that is paresthesia, which is the tingling and numbness sensation, that tingling, numbness, burning or pricking sensation that is usually felt in the hands, arms, legs or feet, but it can also occur in other parts of the body. Type 1 diabetes is the result of interactions of genetic, environmental and immunological factors that ultimately lead to destruction of pancreatic beta cells and insulin deficiency. The susceptibility to type 1 diabetes involves multiple genes. And the major susceptibility gene is located in the HLA region on chromosome 6, and the strongest association is with class 2 MSC genes. This HLA-DR is an MSC class 2 cell surface receptors, which is encoded by human leukocyte antigen complex, that is HLA, and it presents antigen to the helper T cells and thus involved in initiating the immune response. Most individuals with type 1 diabetes, they have HLA-DR3 and or HLA-DR4 haplotype. However, most individuals who inherit these HLA alleles do not develop diabetes, indicating that these genes contribute to the disease but do not by themselves cause it. Now, environmental factors. The autoimmune process is thought to be triggered by an infectious or environmental stimulus, for example, the viral infections like mumps, rubella, Coxsackie B virus. Third is immunologic. So the fundamental immune abnormality in the type 1 diabetes is failure of self-tolerance in the T cell specific for beta cell antigen. One consequence of loss of self-tolerance is the production of autoantibodies against a variety of beta cell antigens, including insulin and the beta cell enzyme glutamic acid decarboxylase, that is GAD, glutamic acid decarboxylase. And this islet destruction is mediated by T lymphocytes rather than islets autoantibodies. So genetic, environmental and immunological factors ultimately leads to destruction of pancreatic beta cells, and it further leads to insulin deficiency, that is absolute insulin deficiency in type 1 diabetes. Type 2 diabetes is characterized by insulin resistance as well as relative insulin deficiency. It is the most common form of diabetes and it usually occurs in adulthood. 90% of the diagnosed cases of diabetes are of type 2 diabetes. There is no involvement of viral or autoimmune antibodies like type 1 diabetes. Disease develops gradually without obvious symptoms. Polyuria, polydipsia of several weeks duration is present, but polyphagia is less common, but it can also occur in type 2 diabetes. These patients do not require insulin for survival, although insulin eventually will be required to control hyperglycemia and to keep HbA1c below 7% in 90% of the patients of type 2 diabetes. There is no or minimal ketosis, so diabetic ketoacidosis, it is not common in type 2 diabetes as it is common in type 1 diabetes. The acute complication seen in type 2 diabetes is hyperglycemic hyperosmolar state, which is characterized by severe hyperglycemia and dehydration as well as altered mental status. Pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes involves insulin resistance, but insulin resistance alone will not lead to diabetes. Type 2 diabetes develops in insulin resistant individuals who also show impaired beta cell functions. So what is this insulin resistance? It is the failure of target tissues to respond normally to insulin, and these target tissues are liver, muscle and adipose tissue. So as a result of insulin resistance, there is hyperglycemia as well as increased free fatty acid in the circulation. So this insulin resistance, it can develop because of various factors like genetics. Obesity can also lead to insulin resistance, sedentary lifestyle and aging. These are also contributing factors for development of insulin resistance. And further, because of this insulin resistance, as a compensatory mechanism, there is hyperinsulinemia, that is increased production of insulin from beta cells of islets of Langerhans. So it leads to hyperinsulinemia. And it further leads to impaired glucose tolerance. And eventually, there is decline in the beta cell function. So two mechanisms are very important, insulin resistance and beta cell dysfunction. So as a result of beta cell dysfunctions, which is also contributed by genetic factors, increased glucose level, that is glucose toxicity, and as there are circulating free fatty acids because of insulin resistance, that will also lead to decline in the beta cell functions, and eventually it leads to type 2 diabetes. So insulin resistance and decline of beta cell functions, together they result in type 2 diabetes. Obesity is the most common cause of insulin resistance, and it is associated with type 2 diabetes. Adipocytes are considered as endocrine organ, and because they release adipokines, there are certain pro-hyperglycemic adipokines secreted by adipocytes and certain anti-hyperglycemic adipokines. The anti-hyperglycemic ones are leptin, adiponectin, omentin and wisfatin, while pro-hyperglycemic adipokines are resistin, tumor necrosis factor alpha, interleukin-6 and retinol binding protein. So the release of adipokines, and because of insulin resistance, there is increased free fatty acid due to increased lipolysis, and this increased free fatty acid levels is associated with insulin resistance. So there is inverse relationship of this free fatty acid and insulin sensitivity. Inflammation is also one of the major contributor of insulin resistance as well as beta cell dysfunction. So together, the adipokines, free fatty acid and inflammation leads to insulin resistance. Normally, beta cells of islets of Langerhans, they secrete the hormone insulin, and it is in normal condition, the blood glucose level is maintained by this insulin in the well-fed condition. But whenever there is insulin resistance, it leads to compensatory hyperplasia of these beta cells. So there is more secretion of insulin because of insulin resistance. So there is increased secretion by the beta cells and it leads to impaired glucose tolerance. Later, there is failure of beta cells, and because of the insulin resistance, first there is compensatory increase in the insulin level, but in the later stages there is beta cell failure, which further leads to decreased insulin secretion by beta cells, and it results in the type 2 diabetes. So that's how obesity is related to insulin resistance, and insulin resistance is ultimately related to beta cell dysfunction, and together it leads to type 2 diabetes. Now let's see the metabolic changes seen in type 1 diabetes. So in type 1 diabetes, there is absolute insulin deficiency. What happens in the liver? Normally insulin increases glycogenesis and lipogenesis in the liver, and it inhibits gluconeogenesis and glycogenolysis. But in the absence of insulin, the reverse processes occurs. That is, there is decrease in glycogenesis, decrease in lipogenesis, but there is an opposed increase in the gluconeogenesis as well as glycogenolysis occurs, and this further leads to increased blood glucose concentration. Now, in the adipose tissue and the muscle, the glucose uptake is dependent on insulin, but due to lack of insulin, there is decreased uptake of glucose, and there is decreased peripheral uptake of glucose in muscle and decreased glycogenesis, but there is increased glycogenolysis. Likewise, in the adipose tissue also, there is decreased peripheral uptake of glucose, decreased lipogenesis, and increased lipolysis. So ultimately, in type 1 diabetes, due to lack of insulin, there is increased glucose concentration. So there is hyperglycemia, and because of increased lipolysis, because of unopposed action of hormone-sensitive lipase. Hormone-sensitive lipase is inhibited by insulin, but as there is lack of insulin, the hormone-sensitive lipase causes degradation of triacylglycerol into fatty acid and glycerol, and that's why there is increased fatty acid concentration, which will further oxidized by beta oxidation of fatty acid, results in the formation of acetyl-CoA, and there is increased acetyl-CoA pool, which will further lead to ketone bodies production. So there is ketone body formation is seen in type 1 diabetes, as well as there is increased triglyceride level. So type 1 diabetes is characterized by increased glucose, increased free fatty acid, increased ketone bodies, and increased triglycerides. Now let's understand the biochemical basis of ketoacidosis and hypertriglyceridemia seen in type 1 diabetes. So we know that in type 1 diabetes there is lack of insulin. So there is, because of lack of insulin, there is loss of inhibitory effect on hormone sensitive lipase, which cause degradation of triacylglycerol into fatty acid and glycerol. So as the effect is lost, this hormone sensitive lipase causes breakdown of TAG into glycerol and fatty acids. Now these fatty acids are activated to form fatty acyl-CoA, and these fatty acyl-CoA are transported into the mitochondria, that is the liver mitochondria, through carnitine shuttle. Now this fatty acyl-CoA, they undergo beta oxidation of fatty acid, which ultimately results in the formation of acetyl-CoA. So there is increased acetyl-CoA seen in type 1 diabetes. Now what is the fate of this acetyl-CoA? This acetyl-CoA can enter TCA cycle and get oxidized. But as there is more production of acetyl-CoA, this cycle gets saturated. So there is, due to the excessive production, this TCA cycle is inhibited. The another reason why acetyl-CoA cannot be oxidized through TCA cycle is that one of the intermediate of TCA cycle, that is oxaloacetate, it is involved in the process of gluconeogenesis. Because in the type 1 diabetes, due to lack of insulin, this process of gluconeogenesis is increased, and this oxaloacetate is being utilized for the process of gluconeogenesis, and that's why acetyl-CoA cannot be oxidized through this TCA cycle. This is also one of the reason, and it ultimately leads to increased acetyl-CoA production, which will further divert it to ketone bodies production in the liver mitochondria. So it results in ketoacidosis. This is the biochemical basis of ketoacidosis seen in type 1 diabetes. Now what leads to increased triglyceride? Now all the fatty acid cannot lead to formation of ketone bodies. So they cannot be utilized for the formation of ketone bodies. So some of the fatty acids are packaged in the liver in the form of triacylglycerol. So they are utilized for the formation of triacylglycerol. Now normally what happens in the liver, triacylglycerol are packaged in the lipoprotein, that is VLDL, very low density lipoprotein. And triacylglycerol is also derived from intestine through chylomicron. Chylomicron is also a lipoprotein which carries exogenous, that is dietary triglyceride, from intestine to the peripheral tissue. And the function of VLDL is to carry triglyceride from liver to the peripheral tissue. So both chylomicrons and VLDL, they carry triacylglycerol to the peripheral tissue. Peripheral tissue are extrahepatic tissues like adipose tissue and muscle. In the adipose tissue and muscle, in the capillary wall, there is one enzyme is present which is called as lipoprotein lipase. This enzyme catalyzes the breakdown of this triacylglycerol. This triacylglycerol is converted into fatty acid and glycerol. Fatty acids are taken up by both adipose tissue and muscle. In the adipose tissue, fatty acids are stored again in the form of triacylglycerol, while muscle can utilize fatty acid for energy purpose. But in type 1 diabetes, there is lack of insulin, and insulin is required for activation of this enzyme lipoprotein lipase. So as there is no insulin, this lipoprotein lipase cannot be activated. So there is no action of lipoprotein lipase now. So the breakdown of triacylglycerol into fatty acid and glycerol is inhibited, and that's why it leads to increased triglyceride and increased VLDL in the circulation. So this is the biochemical basis of hypertriglyceridemia seen in type 1 diabetes. The metabolic changes seen in type 2 diabetes mellitus is the result of insulin resistance. So ultimately, there is increased glucose concentration, that is hyperglycemia, increased free fatty acid level, and increased triglyceride level. So metabolic changes are hyperglycemia, there is dyslipidemia, but in case of type 2 diabetes, there is minimal ketosis, or it can be absent because circulating insulin is present, and that's why it does not lead to formation of ketone bodies. But due to increased acetyl-CoA pool and increased beta acid oxidation, there is increased acetyl-CoA pool, and it can further lead to increased cholesterol synthesis. So there is hypercholesterolemia seen in type 2 diabetes. So type 2 diabetes is characterized by hyperglycemia, dyslipidemia, but usually minimal or absent ketosis. Now let's understand the biochemical basis of clinical features seen in diabetes. And the most common symptoms of diabetes are 3 P's, that is polyuria, polydipsia, and polyphagia. So in the diabetes mellitus, it is characterized by hyperglycemia and ketoacidosis, specifically type 1 diabetes. So because of this hyperglycemia, there is increased blood glucose concentration, and if it exceeds the renal threshold, that is 180 mg per deciliter, then there is excretion of glucose in the urine, and it is called as glycosuria. So there is glycosuria occurs in diabetes when blood glucose concentration exceeds 180 mg per deciliter, and this glycosuria induces osmotic diuresis, and because of this osmotic diuresis, there is polyuria, and this results in loss of water and electrolytes through urine. Now if this renal water loss, it is combined with hyperosmolarity, and this hyperosmolarity is due to increased level of glucose in the blood. So because of that, there is depletion of intracellular water, so there is volume depletion, and it triggers osmoreceptors in the brain. And because of triggering of osmoreceptors, there is increased thirst, and it leads to polydipsia. Now, deficiency of insulin also leads to catabolism of both proteins in the muscle and lipolysis. So there is increased fatty acid and increased amino acid level. And these glucogenic amino acids produced by the proteolysis, they are taken up, and by the liver, they are used as building blocks for glucose. So this catabolism of proteins and fats, they induce a negative energy balance, which in turn leads to increase in appetite, that is polyphagia. So thus, the triad of clinical features of diabetes, that is polyuria, polyphagia and polydipsia. So this is a classic triad of diabetes. But despite the increased appetite, the catabolic effect dominates and it results in the weight loss and muscle weakness. So the combination of polyphagia and weight loss, it is paradoxical and it should always point to the possibility of diabetes. So in today's video on diabetes, we have learned definition, classification of diabetes, diagnostic criteria, then pathogenesis of diabetes, various metabolic changes seen in both type 1 and type 2 diabetes. So let's summarize the differences between type 1 and type 2 diabetes. The age of onset in type 1 diabetes is childhood and adolescence, and while in type 2 it is usually occurs in adulthood. Type 1 diabetes is due to beta cell destruction and there is absolute insulin deficiency, while type 2 diabetes is characterized by insulin resistance as well as relative insulin deficiency. The patients of type 1 diabetes are of normal weight or there can be weight loss, but type 2 diabetes is associated with obesity. Type 1 diabetes is less common as compared to type 2 diabetes. 10% of the diagnosed cases of diabetes belong to type 1 and 90% belong to type 2 diabetes. The genetic susceptibility, there is genetic linkage to MSC class 2 genes commonly seen in type 1 diabetes. It is also linked to polymorphism, but there is no such linkage, HLA linkage seen in type 2 diabetes. The acute complication of type 1 diabetes is diabetic ketoacidosis and it is seen in the absence of insulin therapy, while type 2 diabetes, it is not associated with diabetic ketoacidosis, but it is most commonly associated with hyperglycemic hyperosmolar coma. Then the plasma insulin level, there is progressive decrease in the insulin level in type 1 diabetes, while in the early stages of type 2 diabetes there is increased blood insulin due to compensation of beta cells of islets of Langerhans, and that in the later stages there is normal or moderate decrease in the insulin. The various factors play important role in the pathogenesis of type 1 diabetes. Those are genetic, environmental and immunological factors. While type 2 diabetes mellitus, insulin resistance is important along with the beta cell dysfunction or deficiency, and multiple obesity associated factors are also linked to insulin resistance. They are involved in the pathogenesis of type 2 diabetes. Now in the type 1 diabetes, there is autoimmune insulitis and there is amyloid deposition in the islets in the later stages of type 2 diabetes. And due to this autoimmune insulitis, in type 1 diabetes there is beta cell depletion which leads to islet atrophy, while in type 2 diabetes also there is beta cell depletion but it is mild. In the next video we will study about various complications of diabetes and the mechanisms of those complications. So thank you for watching.